యూ హ్యావ్ ది లగ్జరీ ఆఫ్ విచ్ ఐ డోంట్ హ్యావ్ ఆన్ ది డయాస్. ఫ్రెండ్స్, దిస్ సెషన్ ఈజ్ మోర్ అబౌట్ ది రిఫ్లెక్షన్స్. యాజ్ ఏ ప్రాక్టీసింగ్ పొలిటీషియన్, వాట్ ఆర్ మై రిఫ్లెక్షన్స్ అబౌట్ ది కంటెంపరీ పాలిటిక్స్, వేర్ డూ వి స్టాండ్? దట్ ఈస్ ది సెంట్రల్ థీమ్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ సెషన్. వి ఆర్ ఇన్ పాలిటిక్స్, వి వెన్ ఐ సే పీపుల్ లైక్ మీ. పాలిటిక్స్ ఈజ్ నాట్ ఎ చారిటీ. వి ఆర్ ఇన్ పాలిటిక్స్ మీన్స్ వి ఆర్ దేర్ ఫర్ పవర్. ప్లీజ్ డోంట్ హ్యావ్ ఎనీ కన్ఫ్యూజన్ అబౌట్ ఇట్. క్వశ్చన్ ఈజ్ పవర్ ఫర్ వాట్? పవర్ ఫర్ ఎ లార్జర్ ఆబ్జెక్టివ్, నాట్ జస్ట్ ఫర్ ఎంజాయింగ్ పవర్ బట్ ఫర్ ఎ లార్జర్ ఆబ్జెక్టివ్ ఆఫ్ డూయింగ్ గుడ్ టు ద పీపుల్. సో మై ఫస్ట్ ప్రిమైస్ ఈజ్, ఫస్ట్ రిఫ్లెక్షన్ ఈజ్ దట్ సిన్స్ వి ఆర్ ఇన్ పవర్, వి ఆర్ ఇన్ పాలిటిక్స్, అగర్ సత్తా లేనే కి లియే నహీ హై, ఇఫ్ ఇట్ ఇస్ నాట్ ఫర్ క్యాప్చరింగ్ పవర్, ఐ షుడ్ బి కంటిన్యూయింగ్ ఇన్ ఆర్ఎస్ఎస్. ఆర్ఎస్ఎస్ ఆల్సో వాంట్స్ టు డూ గుడ్ ఫర్ ది నేషన్. విద్యార్థి పరిషత్ ఆల్సో వాంట్స్ టు డూ గుడ్ ఫర్ ది నేషన్. సో ఇఫ్ ఐ ఆమ్ ఇన్ బీజేపీ విత్ ది సేమ్ ఆబ్జెక్టివ్, మై పాత్ విల్ బి త్రూ పవర్. హమ్నే ఇస్లే తయ్ కియా, ఫ్రమ్ పంచాయత్ టు పార్లమెంట్ ఎవ్రీవేర్ వీ షుడ్ బి ఇన్ పవర్. ఉస్మే చారిటీ నయే, నేనే సాబ్ బిచారే ఓ బి హమారే లోగ్ హై, నో బిచారాపన్. వి ఆర్ దేర్, వీ హ్యావ్ టు బి ఇన్ పవర్. వై? బికాస్ వీ వాంట్ టు డూ సంథింగ్ గుడ్ ఫర్ ది కంట్రీ త్రూ దిస్ యాక్టివిటీ కాల్డ్ పాలిటిక్స్. I am not in politics to sit in the opposition perpetually. So first is that we needed to do good to the country through politics. That's why we needed power. So we are focused on expanding our political footprint all over the country. 5 years down the line, today I feel happy and proud that we have been able to expand into hitherto inaccessible, unimaginable areas also. Like today, since I also handle northeastern affairs for our party, we have our governments in 6 out of the 7 northeastern states. The 7th state is most likely going to be our state in a couple of weeks from now, Mizoram. So first objective for us has been to win state after state. We wanted to have our government in Karnataka also, no apologies. Thoda delay ho gaya, ho jayega. So we have expanded our footprint right from Kashmir to, you know, metaphorically speaking, Kanyakumari, because we have a member of parliament from Kanyakumari in BJP. Similarly, from the west coast to the easternmost corner of our country in Nagaland, we have our governments today. Why we are in power is the critical question that we have to ask ourselves. We are in power for a few very important, laudable objectives. One, we need an accountable public life of probity, which was lacking in this country. Politics and politicians have become utterly unaccountable. We needed a politics of probity. Looking back past 4 years, I can say with confidence that is what the country has experienced in 4 years, a politics of accountability, a politics of probity, a clean politics. We have seen corrupt regimes, corrupt politics. We have seen politics of families, heredity, unaccountability. Thankfully, in Prime Minister Modi, in our government, we are not afflicted by any of these malices that have been affecting our polity. Fighting corruption has been a big challenge in this country. So many efforts have been made. But we all ended up realizing that it's not going to happen, especially the corruption in the political system. But then we invented a new model of accountable politics. You know, to make politics accountable, to make politics corruption free, should not start from the bottom, it should start from the top. Aaj akhbar kholenge to aapko khabar dikhega ki Belagavi ke municipal office mein some clerk was caught red-handed taking a bribe of 500 rupees. Then you say that there is a big fight going on against corruption. Fair enough, one has to do that. But you cannot eradicate corruption by only catching a clerk in a municipal office and not catching somebody sitting in Vidhan Sodha in Bengaluru or secretariat in Delhi, South Block and North Block in Delhi. It has to be a top-down thing. You arrest corruption at the top. You bring cleanliness at the top. It will flow downwards. And I can only make one statement to end this first part. We have in Prime Minister Modi a leader who is not only non-corrupt, but incorruptible. You need that kind of a leadership for cleansing the system. So, on probity front, I would say we have set a new standard, new benchmark. The next government, who not in the immediate soon, maybe after a decade or so, whenever they come, they have a new benchmark now. Number two, we are in power to ensure that this country's unity is protected. After probity, it is the challenge of unity of the country, and I don't have to talk much about it. You have seen 4-5 years of riot-free India, communal conflagration-free India, a united India. So on unity front, we have been able to maintain country's unity in a very effective manner. The third mission for us was, objective for us was prosperity. We are in the government. We are here not just to manage the economy. There was a discussion about these GDP figures. Not just to have data claims, like we have 7.8% GDP growth rate. It's a data, it's a figure. And as somebody rightly pointed out, how much to genuinely trust these figures? Although data is not incorrect. But data doesn't tell you the full story. Prosperity means the happiness, the prosperity of the last man. GDP means if 100 rich people in the country can triple or quadruple their income, your GDP will go up. We decided that prosperity should reach the last man. So towards that end, we have taken enormous measures, enormous steps. It has resulted in, of course, good GDP rates, but also the last man getting benefited out of these measures. The fourth is security, both internal and external security. On internal security front, we have been able to control the forces that are out to destroy our nation, our nation's unity, our nation's peace. Today, those forces are on the run. There was a time just few years ago when India used to have about 140-150 districts categorized as Maoism affected districts. Today, hardly 20 districts are there. In next few months' time, India will be completely Maoist insurgency free. There is a new phenomena called urban Maoism, provoking urban gullible groups into taking to violent means, using media, using literature, using social media. These urban Naxal, urban Maoist groups are under our radar today. Take my words, when the fight against Maoism goes, there will not be any distinction made between urban Maoist and rural Maoist. Everybody will be tackled. You may be a professor, you may be a doctor, you may be a so-called NGO activist. But if you fall under the definition or category of urban Naxal, you will be in jail. This is a clear-cut message that our government has given across, and we are going to give it to people who try to disturb the peace, sitting in cities, sitting in ivory towers, sitting in glass houses, enjoying good life. All these years, they have sacrificed our youngsters in the villages, in the countryside. And today, they are using the urban gullible people as their tools. That shall not be allowed. And when you talk about security, the immediate areas come into mind are areas like Kashmir or areas like Northeast, where insurgency used to be a big challenge. Today, in those areas, we have used effective, forceful measures to contain these forces. Today, in states like Kashmir, the terrorists are literally on the run. Not a single day passes. Not a single day passes without a few terrorists being eliminated, neutralized. And we made it clear that the fight against terror shall go on ruthlessly until the last terrorist in the Kashmir Valley is neutralized. There used to be a great distinction in Kashmir before we came to power. The infiltrators and local boys. If he's a local boy, there used to be a different treatment. We said nothing doing. If you hold a gun against the state, Indian state, whether you are from Pakistan or Pulwama, you will be treated similarly, you will be neutralized. It's a stern message that we gave. And as far as the international security is concerned, today we have strengthened our security establishment enormously in the last 4 years. Somebody asked a question about demonetization, whether it has benefited, I mean, in the sense of currency and all that. Other aspects being addressed by Jayanti. I tell you one very good benefit out of it was that the government's revenues have gone up. Earlier only in our country only 1 million people used to pay taxes, income tax. Today after demonetization, 1 crore people are paying income tax. And remember, that has helped our government manage the fiscal deficit at a controllable level below 3.3. And the money that has been accrued to the government, the revenues that have been accrued, have been used to strengthen our security apparatus. Today, India is a proud country with nuclear capable army, navy and air force, all the three elements. We are strengthening our navy. We will be acquiring close to 300 vessels in next 10 years' time. India today is one of the strongest security forces in the world. We have strengthened our security establishment. Our economy is on a very strong footing today. We have almost overtaken Great Britain to become a world's fifth largest economy. And the predictions are 10 years from now, India will be the third largest economy in the world. We are moving in the direction. Friends, but the three, four things that I mentioned, in themselves, may not get us another win. Because we have done such things in the past also. When Vajpayee ji was the Prime Minister, that time also, if you look at the record was the same. You need something more. That is the fifth element, and that is the theme of this conference. That is the element of dignity. Every citizen in the country, for that matter, every Indian living anywhere in the world should feel proud of being an Indian. And I can tell you, 4 years down the line, 5 years down the line, we have accorded that dignity to the last man in this country. Earlier, governments used to look at people either as voters or at the most as citizens. Subhrasht asked this question. Rights-based approach of the previous governments. They have rights-based approach, riots-based approach, loot-based approach. They had many approaches, not just rights-based approach alone. What was our approach? Our approach has been that the people of this country are not just voters, nor even just citizens. You are the stakeholders of this country. You have stakes in this country. You think the stakes are only with the ministers and bureaucrats? We said, no. In this country, citizens are the stakeholders of our whole development dream. Look at our whole 120 plus programs that Prime Minister Modi has announced. Two things stand out very eloquently. You can see them, you can feel them. Number one, that citizens are participants, not just beneficiaries or mute spectators. They're participants. If you want a clean India, you have to do it. Government will support you. You are a stakeholder. We have given them dignity as stakeholders. You know, the MasterCard management has approached the American administration complaining against government of India. Why? Because you see, government of India is following unethical practices by promoting Rupaya card. What is Rupaya card? It is like a MasterCard, a credit card that a rickshaw wala, that a pushcart vendor, that a daily wage earner owns today. You go to a hotel, whether it is required or not required, you pull out your debit card or credit card, which is Visa card or MasterCard, and you pay at the counter to show that you are a very progressive, advanced man when it comes to economy. In the queue behind you is the rickshawwala. He also today pulls out a card, the Rupaya card. He also presents that card. This is stakeholdership. All are equal. All have same access to facilities. Swachh Bharat, just now, JNG mentioned about Ayushman Bharat. Earlier, big hospitals used to be there in Bengaluru, Mangaluru. With prosperity growing in tier 2 cities, today you have some of them in tier 2 cities. Mark my words, Ayushman Bharat, when we announced 5 lakh rupee medical insurance to the poorest family, they are going to go to taluka centers. That is the whole objective. Best medical facilities should go to tier 3 cities, tier 4 cities. So that a person living there will have same access to his heart ailment, his serious ailment, as somebody living in Bengaluru, Mangaluru, for that matter, Belgavi. Idea is to give dignity to that man so that he leads a dignified life. And lastly, look at the whole Swachh Bharat. Dignity is not just a vague thing, an abstract thing. Dignity is something one should experience, one should feel it. We gave dignity to 30 crore people who are last in the queue through Jan Dhan Yojana. Jan Dhan Yojana was to make the last man under a flyover an integral part of Indian economy. Today he is there in the banking net. He is also having a Rupaya card. Through Swachh Bharat, people thought Swachh Bharat is about cleaning the country. Of course it is about cleaning the country. But tell me, for cleaning the country, we have municipal departments in all states. Every municipal corporation is mandated to clean the city. Why Swachh Bharat? Because Swachh doesn't just mean keeping your vicinity clean. It is to give dignified life to our people. You know, in India, 60% of the rural women did not have access to a toilet until we launched this campaign. The result was they used to be subjected to rapes. Because you have to go out when it is dark. Women used to be subjected to violence. Women used to be afflicted with diseases because you go out, you don't know where you are going. Disease, a man gets a disease, he is affected. If a woman gets a disease, the entire family is affected. Children are affected. Number three, this will surprise you. In India, especially rural India, we had this data in the past. A school going boy will drop out of the school in the rural countryside after grade 10. Why? By the time he completes grade 10, he knows about Archimedes, he knows about Pythagoras, he knows about Einstein, he doesn't know how to repair his switch. If power goes off, he doesn't know what to do. So he thinks, yaar, ye bahut ho gaya. Ye Pythagoras, ye garas, wo garas, bahut ho gaya. Bas ho gaya. Ghar jaake kaam seekh lenge. But a girl used to drop out of the school in our country at grade 6. By grade 6, she becomes of the age of 10 or 12. Her natural physical condition demands that there is a toilet in the school. You did not have it. We have deprived of women of their safety, their health, their education. Swachh Bharat is meant to address this problem, friends, to give dignity to our women. And I tell you one example, the dignity, how it works. I was in Madhya Pradesh a few months ago. There is a news item in the local paper on the front page with a photograph. Naturally, we see the photograph first. I looked at the photograph. It was a photograph of a newly married couple. But the photo was taken normally, newly married couple photo kahan lete hai? Saath fere ka photo lete hai, reception ka photo lete hai. But this photograph was, these two newly wed boy and girl were standing next to a new toilet. So I got curious. I read the news item. The news item said that this boy's family went to fix up the marriage with the girl's family. And naturally we have this bad practice of dowry. So they demanded some dowry. Out of compulsion, the girl's family agreed to give the dowry. When the girl came to know about it, she told that boy, you see, it's a very bad practice. But since my family is out of compulsion, willing to pay that, I have a condition. Take that money, but build a toilet in your house. Then only I will marry you. And that fellow, out of love for that woman, he built a toilet. Then the marriage was solemnized. The first photo that girl insisted that we should take with the toilet. It's a question of my pride. This is what is called dignity, my friends. We have accorded that dignity to the youth. In this country, youth used to be looked at as job seekers. Unemployed, job seekers. We could have easily announced unemployment bharta. Monthly unemployed ke liye ek 3000 rupya. Would have been the easiest way. But Modi ji said no. That means you are demeaning that person. What you need to do is encourage him to stand on his own feet. That is where the dignity lies, not in searching for jobs. Of course, those who want jobs should get it. We are not against that. But our policy has been that a job seeker young man, can he be transformed into job provider young man? We have done it. Today, a job seeker has been transformed into a job provider through Stand Up India, through Startup India, Scheduled Caste Youth, Scheduled Tribe Youth, Women, OBC, even forward cash. Modi ji asked the banks that you have to give loans of the tune of 50,000 to 15 lakhs. The bank said, sir, we have a system. If you want a loan, you have to put something as guarantee. You have to show something as guarantee. Without guarantee, we won't give any loan. That is the experience of all of you. When you go for loans with banks, they will ask you to put something on Girvi. Modi ji said, for me, my young man or young woman, she or he is my guarantee. I don't need any other guarantee. This is what is called dignifying the human existence. We have dignity part we have added to the whole effort in developing this country. Friends, these five elements, each with own significance, with own import, is what has helped people looking at Prime Minister Modi or this government differently. If it is only about infrastructure, there was a discussion in the afternoon. Infrastructure is important. Of course, you need more roads. You need more flyovers. You need more aircraft. But even after providing all that, in Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naidu lost the election after building 27 flyovers in Hyderabad city. He lost the election. After doing so much such good work, we lost the election in 2004. People want development. But people want development plus. It is that plus which is important. It is that plus where a person connects with you, connects with the political establishment, connects with the government and connects with the Prime Minister and Minister and MLA and MP. That connect is what is important. That has been the effort of our Prime Minister and of our government in the last 4.5 years. I will just make one rider and close. The rider is, firstly, the bottom, if I put it in one nutshell, this is actually what democracy is all about. Democracy is actually an agreement, a contract between the masses and the elected leaders. This is a contract.
I elect you. You are expected to do so-and-so things for me. This is the contract. For the sake of that, I elect you. My rider is, we have tried to do all those things. But in between me and my people, today, there are coming some institutions, some agencies, which are not accountable to anybody. I am accountable. I am running an accountable government. I want to be accountable. But beech mein aata hai, I am not against NGOs. But NGOs with very limited agendas. Ek NGO ka agenda hota hai, the whole agenda of the NGO is to get the law on adultery amended. That's the whole agenda. For that, there is an NGO in Delhi, not accountable to anybody. How many people are really directly concerned with those subjects? But they will go up to Supreme Court. They will influence the whole process. In the process, the entire society is affected. That's how things like Sabarimala happen. Who goes to the Supreme Court? A group of champions of equality of women. There's a group with the only limited agenda, not connected with the reality of the land, go to Supreme Court, project that, you know, this Sabarimala temple is atrocious against the women, freedom of women, equality of women. Equality is there under Article 14 to 21, women equality. Of course, there is women equality, gender equality is enshrined in our constitution. But to tell that to Kerala is like carrying coal to Newcastle. Kerala is a matriarchal society. Women lead that society. I don't know, probably Karnataka. In Karnataka, girls go to the house of the in-laws. In Kerala, boys go to the house of the in-laws. Such a progressive, such an advanced society. Now, these champions of women equality, gender equality, go to Supreme Court projecting as though in Kerala, great injustice is being done to women. It's a temple custom. Nobody has any complaints about it. You want to forcefully send women into the temple. Women are saying, no, 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 we are happy with that custom. It's not that we are against reform. Women going into the temple. But let that reform happen on its own. Gradually it will happen. But the problem in our democracy is these intermediate agencies, these forces which wield enormous influence but not accountable to anybody. These women who went to the Supreme Court, in their affidavit, they told the court that, number one, we are non-believers, we are atheists. We go to temples, we don't go to temples. We are not from Kerala, so we have nothing to do with that temple either. But why we are going to Supreme Court? Because the great holy issue called gender equality is at stake. Friends, today my challenge is that in politics, how do I balance these agencies which have now become in the middle of my path? I want to empower people. I want to connect with the masses. I want to work with them. But we have the challenge of these intermediate agencies. But then it's a new experience for all democracies, not just India. This is a new experience that everybody has in the world. We will tackle it. But let me conclude my initial remarks by saying that on these five fronts, if I reflect, if I look back, I feel that we have given a new politics to this country, a politics of probity, a politics committed to unity, committed to prosperity, committed to security, and most importantly, committed to dignity of our individual citizens of this country.